Hi, I'm Ambassador Sujay, or Susan Johnson Cook, and I'm the author of Rhythms of Rest, 40 Devotions for Women on the Move. And I know you've been on the move, so I'm excited, delighted, and ignited to present to you 40 devotions from women all over the nation. Women who've gone on a retreat with me, we call it Selah by the Sea, where they've learned how to not just work hard, but play hard and rest hard and relax hard. And we also have a bond of sisterhood. So 40 women have written from their hearts. And today we're on Main Street in Sag Harbor at Matriarch, which is woman-owned. So today is for women, by women, about a woman, and we want that woman to be you. We want you to make a U-turn, a Y-O-U-turn. So thank you for joining us. I'm talking today with Reverend Tisha Williams, who is a pastor in this community where I live. I'm in Sag Harbor, New York, and she's the pastor of First Baptist Church of Bridgehampton. And before you go any further, this is what I'd love for you to do. Please press that subscribe button, like, and share. And we want to stay in touch with you. And if you feel free, please also comment. We promise to keep in touch, but most of all, we promise that you'll enjoy this book, Rhythms of Rest, 40 Devotions for Women on the Move, women like you. So, First Baptist Church of Bridgehampton, new pastor.
Yay! Yes, ma'am.
You're now in your third year. So, ma'am, we know you like dancing. She's our DJ on the retreats, you know. It's a faith-based retreat, so we have the prayer in the morning.
Yes,
and we boogie at night. So, well, you're in a community of boogiers up
yes,
in here.
Yes,
so,
yes.
What else helps you? Like, you take the break, you take the naps, mm-hmm. you dance. What are the things that you find during a pandemic that you need to speak about, preach about, talk about?
So one of the things that we had was what Frank Thomas calls a shared human experience. Most of the time as preachers and pastors, we're trying to figure out what to preach about. And for the first time, I didn't have to wonder what to preach about. I knew what we were all going through. And so it was very helpful to have a shared experience where I could preach about grief because we were all grieving. I could preach about rest because we all needed rest. I could preach about change because we were in a season of change. And so I think the pandemic really helped that. And the other thing that the pandemic really helped, I think Dr. Gina Stewart said, COVID is the cradle of creativity. It helped me be really creative. So I preach in all these weird places. I preach from a horse farm. I just preach from a vineyard. I preach from the casket room of a funeral home. I preach near a pool. So I tried to use this time that we are not in the building to embrace and use our whole area as a resource for our preaching and its creativity. So it really inspired me to be creative in this.
So I will say this season, we moved out here from Washington and New York. I was kind of on the train or a plane or a bus every week, and I don't miss it. I really got more work and more income from sitting in front of a Zoom. They were like, can you? I was like, yes,
yes
I can.
Yes.
And so I don't miss the travel. I mean, so what don't you miss about the season?
Ooh, I don't miss being just in the building. I like being beyond the four walls of the building. I love that. The other thing I don't miss worship being insular and closed in. One of the things as a pastor I think that has done my heart such joy is seeing my members take control of their spirituality, take full control and agency over how they relate to God. Because it's not cookie cutter and rote, you had to find new ways to connect with God in this season. Just the idea of people preparing communion tables in their home, that blessed me. When I would get pictures from the members and they would show how they had decorated their tables and put flowers on the tables. I'm sorry, that brought my heart so much joy. So I don't miss, you know,
okay.
that. I love the fact that everyone's sort of taking ownership of how they relate to God. And I hope that will continue.
So there are no more boxes.
No more boxes.
You think out of the box, you preach out of
yes.
the box, you live out of the box. So in Safe Space, in this section, your book, your title is Safe in Her Arms?
Yes.
Will you read it for us, please?
Sure. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." It was a hard week. I found myself emotionally drained. I could not wait to get to the annual retreat for women who desperately needed to pause and reflect. As if the pressure of being a new pastor weren't enough, I now wrestled with the recent discovery of a cancerous mass found on my 91-year-old mother-in-law's lung that had doubled in size within the previous month. This diagnosis was followed by the recommendation that no one wants to hear, hospice care. I was devastated. Have you ever received a diagnosis so severe, information so terrible, or a task so great, it overwhelms you to the point of wanting to escape? Well, that was me. I was no longer retreating, I was escaping. I wonder if this is how young Mary felt after receiving the divine diagnosis that she would give birth to the Savior of the world. This incredible revelation and the overwhelming sense of responsibility fueled her great need to escape and retreat with Elizabeth, her seasoned and wise cousin, who knew all too well the pressure of carrying that which has the power to change the world and rock yours. Mm-hmm. However, can you imagine the relief and overwhelming sense of comfort Mary must have felt when she arrived at Elizabeth's home? The older woman greeted her with cries of blessings and honor in her time of uncertainty and transition. In my season of uncertainty and transition, I found my own Elizabeth in the person of a dear sister. One look at me as I walked into our retreat space, and she wordlessly opened her arms. She held me as I melted and cried. I cried for the workload I was carrying. I cried for the mother-in-law, for my mother-in-law. I cried for the husband I had to stay strong for, and I cried in relief because I had found a safe space in the arms of a seasoned, wise woman who also understood all too well the pressure of being chosen by God to carry that which has the power to change the world. Like Mary, every woman needs an Elizabeth. You also may have the opportunity to be Elizabeth to a sister who has an overwhelming need to escape. And when she does share that need, make sure you keep your door and your arms open. Opening begins with opening one's heart, for that is where true unconditional love begins. One of the reasons to do one-on-one face-to-face conference calls with another is to see how we're doing. So many mistakenly think that when we're asked to introduce ourselves in a setting that people are impressed with who we are. In keeping the door and arms open, we show one another how we are. Nowhere in the world will people ever be the same after this virus trauma that has sickened millions, shattered dreams, halted weddings, eliminated events, canceled our corporations, and more. When I was a kid and folks would be diagnosed
with...
Nowhere in the world will people ever be the same after this virus trauma that has sickened millions, shattered dreams, halted weddings, eliminated events, canceled out corporations, and more. When I was a kid and folks would be diagnosed with cancer, they wouldn't say the word, they would just say the big C. And everyone knew what they were referring to. These days, all one has to say is the virus, and everyone will know what we're talking about. We're all affected and impacted by it. There will be many Marys coming into the spaces where you are, trying to find a place off the beaten path, seeking a sister whose arms and heart are open. That means before they even come, we must prepare our hearts and our minds and be determined to be in a state of readiness, for they will need steadiness. Can you be the Elizabeth in the room? The one who is so connected to the Spirit that the possibilities inside of you leap when you greet each other, knowing you're in the right place with the right sister and you're right on time. Who can you run to? Pray and ask God to provide someone in your life with whom you can retreat. Then ask God for the opportunity to be that safe space for someone else in the future. Thank you.
So I encourage each of you to get your rest. If you can come to one of our retreats, they're dynamite. But you'll also meet some of the other authors who are in this volume on September 10th if you come to our luncheon. And there'll be several things throughout the year that we'll be doing to feature them. For many, it's their first time ever putting pen to paper and being published. And so they are excited. I mean, they're flipping. And we're excited with them. We're excited with you and for you. And we just encourage you to take the rest and get your rhythm, get your flow back. Stella got it one way. She got her groove back. However you get your flow and your groove. But we encourage you to have your rhythms of rest. And so it is our honor to have you, and thank you for your support as friends, as neighbors, as sisters. And thank you so much for also being purchasers of our book. So thank you very much for staying.
Can I say one thing? I just want us to certainly honor Ambassador Susan Johnson Cook. She is such a trailblazer, such a leader. She does not have to do what she does. And the fact that you give so freely of your time, your energy, and your wisdom, it is not lost on me. And I know I speak for 39 others who feel the same way. And so thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for pouring out so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.